So a few of you actually have been lucky enough to get a job offer in technology consulting or consulting in general, and the main questions I get from you guys is what exactly should I expect, what for, what should I exactly expect when I get the offer, after I get the offer, and exactly when I start, and also what should I do on my first project. So I'm going to split this into two videos. Today I'm going to focus on exactly what you should be doing on your first project ever or when you first start any project. And make sure to check out my video over here on exactly how you get staffed, how a project actually is, before you get into what exactly you should be expecting. So in this particular video, I want to focus on three aspects: project, people, and tech. Project would be focused on what about the project you need to know, and then also people, like who are the key people you should know, and then tech, what are the key things you should be doing for tech. And the first thing for project is you want to figure out the status at this particular point. No matter what, there may be times where you made projects at the very beginning where it's not even started, and you may also be projects in the middle where you're kind of like in the between, where you, either someone has left the company or maybe they rolled off to a different project or maybe they just need more support. You can't always be expected to go from the very beginning, so you may actually have to join the project from the very beginning and pick it off right at the very start. So that way you have to be ready right out of the gate. So there's a lot of things you could do from that. And also maybe at the end when you have to be support, if maybe the project is already live and then you have to be on support, there's so many places in the life cycle that you can be in and your project will be completely different. But either ways, there's so many ways you can really get into up to speed on this project. And this is what I'm gonna go into. And then next one is really, what are you in charge of and what are you doing? So you may be confused, like, okay, yeah, I'm on a project, but there's so many aspects that come in a project. I'm not talking about project management. I'm not talking about the budget. I'm talking about the actual work in the project. So for example, in my work, it's Workday Financials. So in our particular area, we split up into like supplier accounts, customer revenue, banking, business assets, financial accounting, all those kind of things. We specialize in a particular area, and then sometimes you may have consultants to support you, or you are the one supporting them. So this is like where you want to figure out, can you specialize in this particular area? Are you knowledgeable in this area? How much work are you going to be doing? Maybe you're kind of specializing in the industry. So let's say, for example, if it's a nonprofit, you are the nonprofit subject matter expert. You won't exactly be doing everything, but you may be advising on maybe something that's like specific to the industry for this particular implementation or project. Or maybe you're like the consultant to the consultant. So there's so many things out there where, depending on the role, depending on the project, depending on the industry, depending on the client, there's so many differences. But the first thing you want to do is make sure if you figure out what exactly you're doing, and also to what extent. Because if you're leading a particular work stream, you want to make sure you have the capability to lead, but also have the support behind you. Because if you start on a project midway, which I've definitely had to do that before, lead out of the gate, I was like, whoa, I don't even know anything about the client history or what to expect. So I had to kind of act blind. And a lot of this could also be avoided if you do a lot of your homework beforehand. So you want to also be able to do a lot of knowledge transfer sessions. Honestly, I don't think there's ever been a good knowledge transfer session I've ever had. It's always been, here's like a few hours and you have to know everything we've done for the past few months within these few hours. It's never effective. Honestly, it's really just, I think the most effective is if you had all the documentation that they worked on. But again, this just means that they have good documentation. If you have no documentation, you're pretty much screwed. So this is where they probably send you all the email chains that they've been on, and then all the documentation they've worked on, and tell you exactly what is the down low for this particular client or this particular project or work stream. This is where you have to absorb everything within a few hours. And sometimes it's not even a few hours. I've had one which is just 1 hour, and then they just left the company the next day. I was like, oh, I don't even have anyone to talk to about it. So for this kind of project, it's really good to kind of make sure you get all the support you can. And sometimes you may have to actually have no support and just take on all you can, as much as you can. But you're definitely gonna have to work with your team in terms of maybe you need support, or maybe you need to work with the project manager, maybe add more hours or provide more from the actual client to get the knowledge you need. So that way you can be as productive out of the gate. And so that's everything that comes into the actual project aspect. I think honestly, the part that would probably be more important is the people aspect. So not only just about your team members, you want to be able to get everything you need to know about your client. So I'm not talking about the industry or the company, I'm talking about the people, the key decision makers, the stakeholders. You want to make sure you know who who needs to be in every meeting, who is the lead, who is the contact person for every single thing you need to do. And that way you can be very prepared and actually do the research on what you need to do. Because if you just start very vague and it's like, okay, we're gonna go over this, but then they're not even the right people in the room, you just wasted their time, you wasted your time. So you wanna make sure you know who are the key people, so that way if you do need to ask a question, you can get the answer as quick as possible instead of going through all these hoops. So what a lot of people do is that they get little charts and say like, okay, who's in charge of every little area, and then who's the counterpart in the client area. So that way it's easy to say, so this group works with this group. So for example, for me, when it comes to business assets, I could put myself down for at least the Accenture side, and then what I would have two counterparts on the client side that I work directly with. So if I were to go on PTO, or if I was gonna roll out the project, I can just tell the next person who's gonna take over and know exactly how that takes off. So I would just probably forward the email over to that person, and then also know who are the counterparts to be talking to in terms of that functional area. Then you also want to introduce yourself to either engagement manager and project manager. Honestly, depending on how you got the project to begin with, you may have already done it. If they reached out to you, perfect. They've already done it, they already know why they want you, but you also want to reach out to them, because I had one where the project manager reached out to me, not the engagement manager. In our case, it's really called the delivery lead. So I have to introduce myself to the delivery lead and also make sure they know what I'm doing, because the delivery lead could sometimes be very busy with so many other things too. They're sometimes also involved with sales and also working with the client for maybe a change order. So you wanna make sure to introduce yourself so that way people know about you when conversations come up and it's not like left field. And honestly, the project managers and engagement managers or delivery leads, they do work with each other a lot, but sometimes things fall through the crack and you wanna make sure you introduce yourself to them directly if you haven't worked with them. And having this kind of communication is really key when it comes to success of a project, because you want them to be able to support you at any point. So if there's a point where you're like between the client and what your own demands are, you have to work with them so that way you guys are on a middle ground, and it's really hard if you don't have a relationship with them. Then you also want to build rapport with the client. And what I'm saying is that either on site or on a call or an email, you want to make sure that you have everything that you promised to deliver to them. So if, for example, you specialize in something when it comes to HCM, human capital management, then you can specialize it and say, okay, yes, I am knowledgeable in this. Bring your industry expertise. You want to make sure you basically get them to fall in love with you. You want to show them that you have all the skills and experience that you have. If you don't have the skills and experience that you have, make sure to tell them you're working on it, like you're going for training. When I first started out, they asked me all these questions like, oh, I don't really know at this point, but I'm definitely doing training so that I can better prepare myself later on and provide value for you. It's really the way you phrase it, so that way you can definitely provide value and also have them feel comfortable in you. Because even if you don't have the experience or certifications or skills, it's fine. You just need to be a good consultant and absorb everything like a sponge, because even those people have a lot of value when it comes to the room. Then lastly is tech, and I mentioned briefly about training, and you want to make sure you have everything you need to do what you need to do. So honestly, I would say the biggest part when it comes to onboarding process is honestly the tech portion of it. And not even just about the technology work you're doing, but like, let's say you need to get a whole new laptop, you need to get in VMware, you need to get in their own email system. There's so many things out there, doing their own training, so many things out there. So make sure you do that. A lot of them may have their own compliance training, like diversity inclusion or sexual harassment, all that. Do that, make sure you do that. Make sure you're compliant with all their standards. If you work with a healthcare client, you wanna make sure you're compliant with HIPAA. And then if you have any time that you need to do training, in which case, for example, for me, I start a project right after I finished my training. That wasn't even the whole training, that was just like the core. I still need to do other things. All I did was just, I had training, and then while I was actually working with my project, I was actually working with the project manager, like, oh, this week I think I'm gonna go for training. Does this work for you? So they can forecast your hours properly and also be able to work with your counterparts in the client side or your team, and then make sure it works with their schedule too, because you also need to back up them. Or maybe if there's like a huge milestone or delivery at that time, you want to avoid that, or you want to work around, maybe if, for example, your team member is going on PTO or there's a baby on board or something like that, you want to make sure you avoid that and you coordinate the training time for that. So if you work with training time, you could definitely take time for that. They're always open to that, but just not during crunch time. So make sure to coordinate training for that before you even get your project. So you basically want to be as transparent as possible to your project manager and to your delivery lead and to your team. You want to be able to know who you directly report to as well, so that way when you talk to them, so like, let's say, for example, when I went on my two-week PTO, I told my I told my functional lead, I told my project manager, I told my delivery lead, I told my entire team that I was working on. I even talked to my counterpart when it comes to the client side, and I talked to my other projects. So I did the same exact thing, and I put on my Outlook calendar invite. I did everything. So that way everything is completely clear and we know exactly what to expect. So lastly, when it comes to technology, you also want to make sure during that knowledge transfer session you had, if you can, to also be able to learn about all the intricacies of that particular industry or client. So even throughout the industries, maybe there's like something particularly different about this client that no other company does. So usually these intricacies can bring a lot of challenges to your work, and knowing about that can really help you out to prepare when you actually start it. So that way you're just not like coming in blind, you kind of have an idea of what to expect, and that way you know how to approach it and exactly how to do it. So that's all I really have when it comes to how to actually get started in a project, what to expect, how you can prepare. This is all I have, and honestly the best way to prepare is to start. So it really depends on the kind of project you have, the client you have, the team you have, the firm you have, so many different things. And honestly, when it comes to all this, it could be completely different even based off of country or so. All of this you need to really start, but you can do a lot of this in terms of trying to prepare yourself. And honestly, the whole point of the career is really just learning on the spot and doing things on the spot. So even if you prepare so much, they may completely change things. So there could be, for example, you're working with a finance director the entire time who built all these systems. Maybe he left the client firm and then now he's like going somewhere else. So now they completely change the system. Or maybe that they just don't have the money more, they've dropped it. There's so many things that can happen, but the best way to do it is at least to prepare for success. So thank you guys so much, and let me know down in the comments below if you have any questions at all. And make sure to subscribe if this is content that you're interested in. Thank you. Bye.